He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
Every animal has unique physical characteristics that are selected for over time, which contribute to its survival and therefore reproduction. However, it is hard to believe that every trait is adaptive in the same way. It is easy to understand how running faster, jumping higher, and biting harder can help an organism survive, but other features are not so obvious. For example, we have probably all seen the male peacock flash its beautiful tail feathers, more than likely at a zoo. In the wild, such a tail would be quite cumbersome and might make the bird more vulnerable to prey. Why then, you might ask, would a peacock's tail evolve? Recall that natural selection is ultimately about organisms passing their genes along. Being better equipped for survival ensures a greater probability of surviving long enough to reproduce, but we can also look at the reproductive act itself outside of the context of survival. The traits that aid in an animal's ability to reproduce evolve through a process called sexual selection. Sexual selection is a driving force of evolution that can lead to specialized characteristics that, while not adaptive, lead to increased reproductive success. So, how does it work? It essentially comes down to availability over mates. With sexually reproducing species, females produce relatively few gametes, which we know of as eggs, while males produce an excess of gametes, which are called sperm. This imbalance contributes to Bateman's principle, where female reproductive success is limited by access to resources, while male reproductive success is limited by access to females. More powerful males can potentially have many offspring, taking away opportunities from other males and leading to a large variation in reproductive success among the males in a population. However, a successful female is not taking away reproductive opportunities from other females, leading to lower variation in reproductive success among females. If the variance in reproductive success is high in one sex, then the effects of sexual selection will also be high in that sex. To stand out above the rest, these individuals develop secondary sex characteristics, such as a male peacock's tail, to become the best of the competition and successfully reproduce. However, it's not just about the particular sex. In species where parental care is required, reproductive success is affected by the contribution of each sex to raising the offspring. If investment in the offspring is high, the sex caring for the offspring has even more limited reproductive availability, forcing the opposite sex to wait longer for access to mates and increasing their reproductive variance. This steepens the competition for access to mates, leading to stronger sexual selection. If both sexes are involved in parental care, then there are fewer mating opportunities available for both, and therefore lower variation in reproductive success among the sexes, lessening the effects of sexual selection. When parents are busy taking care of offspring, there is less time for copulation. Species where males and females look alike, such as penguins, are called sexually monomorphic, whereas if males and females have significant anatomical differences, such as with humans and many other mammals, these species are called sexually dimorphic. As we touched upon when first introducing natural selection, there are two types of sexual selection, those being intrasexual and intersexual. With intrasexual selection, individuals within the same sex, often males, compete with each other to fight off potential competitors for a female. This can often lead to the development of antlers, horns, or large body sizes. For example, male elephant seals compete over control of a harem, where the largest male gains exclusive access to many females. Intersexual selection, on the other hand, is more like a job interview, where the hiring manager has many choices among potential candidates. Most of the time, females are choosing among males, as females tend to have the highest investment in reproduction, and males have the highest variability in reproductive success. Females choose traits that will lead to increased reproductive success for their offspring. This can lead to males competing amongst each other for female attention, such as the case with animals who lek, which means to take part in a communal breeding display. males aggregate in arenas to perform mating displays for the female, who chooses the best performer as her mate. Frequently, males can spend most of their time at the lek when not foraging for food. While it makes sense for females to choose males that offer increased access to food, protection, or those that are free from parasites, why would females choose between males that don't display any of these obvious benefits? One explanation is that secondary sex characteristics signal increased fitness, that is, capacity for survival and reproductive success. Individuals with prominent secondary sex characteristics are displaying their quality as a mate because these features indicate the presence of genes that will somehow enhance the survival and reproductive success of potential offspring. This is according to the good genes hypothesis. The fact that these individuals with unnecessary and potentially hazardous secondary sex characteristics, such as elaborate plumage, can survive at all, demonstrates the influence of these characteristics on mate selection. This hypothesis is in line with natural selection, since the choosing of these mates would lead to higher reproductive success for the genes associated with these characteristics. However, many scientists believe it may be a bit more arbitrary. R.A. Fisher proposed that females can evolve random preferences for arbitrary traits, and that the advantage of the trait is only apparent if females choose males with the trait, and that offspring with that trait are more sexually attractive to females with that preference. If enough females in a population have that preference, then selection on that trait increases so much that it can lead to runaway sexual selection, a self-reinforcing cycle that leads to the evolution of some arbitrary trait. Like a train that's been derailed, the runaway sexual selection phenomenon can become so extreme that preference for disadvantageous traits, like the large peacock's tail, can become the norm. Sexual selection often occurs in the steps associated with gaining opportunities for reproduction, such as through the attraction and retention of mates. However, sex doesn't always lead to reproductive success. Post-copulatory selection describes the processes that happen during and after sex. For example, there is sperm competition, where a female has access to two or more males, and the sperm compete for access to the egg. This has led to the evolution of traits that increase the likelihood of fertilization, such as longer and larger ejaculates. Females can also choose the sperm from a particular male to fertilize their eggs, exerting biological or chemical means such as destroying sperm, storing sperm, or investing less in a particular offspring. In any case, between intersexual and intrasexual selection, we can begin to understand precisely why traits like sexual dimorphism exist all over the animal kingdom, everywhere from birds to humans, and we can even begin to better understand human psychology when it comes to mate selection.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.